These two people standing over the body had a distinctive type of uniform on. As I recall, black pants, some type of leather jackets with a design on it, and one was wearing combat boots, and the other one was wearing black, looked like patent leather shoes. Haircut real short. So if it was a homicide, I was thinking it was possibly a gang-type homicide.
It wasn't the type of crime a cop based in East Lansing, Michigan, is used to dealing with. It was something that comes from the big city. But Paul Wood has to chuckle now and then as he remembers how the mysterious crime scene wound up on his desk. It all began one peaceful Michigan morning when a farmer named Robert Reed woke up to check on his cornfield. Farmer Reed looked up towards the sun that morning and saw something strange floating across the sky. It wasn't the usual flock of Canadian geese. It looked more like a UFO, if you ask him. As the wind carried the craft down to Bob among his corn, he saw it was a cluster of weather balloons attached to a Super 8 movie camera.
Farmer had no idea. He just found this camera. He was thinking maybe it was a surveillance-type film or something because marijuana is grown down in that part of the state. In fact, marijuana grows wild down there. He thought possibly somebody had a camera set up on a marijuana field and just got away from him or something.
The state police hadn't lost any cameras doing marijuana surveillance. They took this particular camera and they gingerly removed the film. They watched as the images came to life. They expected to see some cornfields and maybe a cow or two, but instead they began to see what appeared to be a cult killing.
It appeared that the body looked like it had laid there for some time, so that didn't make sense. You know, if the body's been dead for some time, two people are standing over it, unless they just found it or something. Then you had the third person that was running away from the two that were there.
The seasoned police investigator studied the bizarre film for clues, for some indication of where this strange scene had taken place. Then they noticed the flashing lights above the crosses. They figured out that the lights were on an elevated train track. Someone recognized it as the famed Chicago L. Detective Wood sent a copy of the film to the Chicago police for immediate investigation.
So one day, when I was just on the phone talking to the Chicago police officer, I told him what we had there. Basically, what I was asking the detective from Chicago was if they had any homicides around the time that we found this film. And of course, the answer was we got homicides almost on a daily basis.
Chicago detectives managed to pinpoint the exact alley where the scene had been filmed. But there was no answer to the identity of the victim or to those around him.
And nobody could determine whether this actually was a homicide or what it was. So Chicago PD then sent the film to the FBI laboratory to have it enhanced. And that's where the FBI got involved.
At about the time the FBI was called in on the case, which was about a year after the film was found, the Chicago police got a tip that helped identify the victim in the case. As it turned out, his name was Trent Reznor. Now, you may not have heard of Trent Reznor. I know I hadn't. But if you're a kid, you may have his picture on your wall. You see, Trent Reznor emerged as an underground rock star last year with a band called Nine Inch Nails. I know, it's more like Nine Inch Noise. But when police found the name of the victim, they also solved the mystery at the same time. They found out that Trent Reznor had masterminded and directed his own death.
And so, the body in the mysterious film was traced to a Chicago heavy metal club. But who shot the film? And who committed the crime? Or was it a crime? Those answers next.
And a little later, no joke.
A year after a film murder scene landed in a cornfield hundreds of miles from Chicago, police and FBI narrowed the case down to the victim's identity. They can be excused for wishing they'd never found him.
It was a mystery that could have come from the mind of David Lynch, only it wasn't a fictional Twin Peaks or a twisted blue velvet imitation of small-town America. This one was for real. A cluster of weather balloons had carried the Super 8 movie camera more than 100 miles from downtown Chicago, across the Great Lakes, to a farmer's field outside of Burr Oak, Michigan. The camera contained film that seemed to have recorded a killing, a cult-like murder with a body surrounded by weird-looking men in strange outfits. The Michigan State Police, the Chicago Police, the FBI spent more than a year investigating the case, trying to determine who the victim was and what had happened to him. They even sent out flyers to area schools in hope of generating leads. Then one day they got a tip that blew the case wide open. The tip came from an art student in Chicago who had spotted something on television that reminded him of a police flyer he had seen. Now, I'm not sure who this art student was or what he was doing at the magical moment, but I imagine it must have been something like this. He must have been at his easel. There must have been a model. And apparently the television was going at full blast at the same time. Something caught the attention of the art student, and it wasn't the woman he had been painting. It was the image on the television screen, the same footage that had baffled lawmen across the nation. After the police got the art student's tip, they were shocked to learn that the weird images on the film had nothing to do with a gang killing or a satanic ritual, but with something many people feel is just as insidious. The film that was found in the cornfield was meant for an underground rock video starring Trent Reznor. This is Trent Reznor, a man with a flair for wearing jewelry in his nose and a total disregard for what police have to go through every day of their lives. You see, Trent Reznor is very much alive.
I don't know, 6 months ago, we got a call from, my manager called me and said, you won't believe what just happened. Got a call from an investigator in Chicago that thinks that I might be dead. So there was talk of me having to go to Chicago to prove that I'm alive, but I never had to do that, so I think they feel a little bit silly, which is good.
After police discovered Reznor to be the body they had been looking for, everything else fell into place. The men around his body were members of his band. The strange jackets were from the costume department. The deathly pallor on Reznor's face was the result of cornstarch. And the camera attached to the balloons was the low-budget equivalent of a Hollywood crane shot, only this one got away.
It was a nice day. It was really warm out. We spent the whole day outside.
We got the balloons from American Science Center.
Yeah, we spent the whole day filling up these balloons with helium, and it kept taking more and more to, like, get enough lift to lift up a camera. We finally got it to work. It was kind of breezy. We knew that that was going to be a problem. It went up, and we were in between these buildings. And a breeze caught it, and it ripped.
I was wondering if it was going to hit someone. It's interesting that our top government agency, the Federal Bureau of Intelligence,
couldn't crack the Super 8
film. It couldn't crack the Super 8 code.
When the Chicago police was approached about the case, they didn't have anything to say about it. And when we found Trent Reznor on the road before a concert, he didn't have any regrets about the wasted year of police work that could have gone into solving some real crimes. In fact, he found it all amusing.
When the news came through that, this was some sort of cult killing, I'd been killed, this great story. Initial reaction was it was really funny. You know, something could be that blown out of proportion and this many people worked up about it. And I felt kind of good that the police had made idiots of themselves, you know.
Did he say idiots? Don't tell that to retired cop Paul Wood. He's just glad that there's one less murder victim to mourn and one less crime to solve.
If anything, this didn't look to me like a high-class production film. It looked like a homemade type something, or kids playing a prank and seeing what would happen. So several people here looked at it, and we still weren't 100% sure. That's why I thought it was our duty to, one way or the other, determine what was on that film.
Paul Wood doesn't wear rings in his nose. He's just a 51-year-old ex-cop who's done everything he could to protect people from the worst things in life, and who had spent the past year working a case that's just a joke to Trent Reznor and his producers. But unlike Reznor, who has no soft spot for cops, Paul Wood has a soft spot for kids and their crazy fads. And despite everything that's happened, he even has a soft spot for rock videos.
In general, they don't bother me. The ones I'm concerned about are the ones that show graphic violence, and I think, the young people that are watching them can be impressionable and be desensitized by what they're watching. It's like, in this society, it seems like life is pretty cheap.